This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Selling Yourself by John Jackson Munsell. 1923. Ohio State University, W. O. Thompson, President. I have read the manuscript of this little volume with accelerated interest. As stated in the foreword, Mr. Munsell has spoken out of a large experience as a practical man to a younger generation. His practical point of view cannot fail to interest the young man looking forward to a career in business or in any of the industries. There is a deal of wholesome advice and suggestion in what Mr. Munsell throws in as he passes along from one phase to another. Nothing is suggested that is out of the reach of the average young man. One reads the pages with a feeling that here is a man in sympathy with young men, speaking plainly and truthfully to them about matters vital to their success and happiness in making their careers. The tone of the book is wholesome throughout. The reading of the book will elicit commendation and praise from those interested in better service and from those preparing to meet that demand. W. O. Thompson, March 28, 1922. Columbus, Ohio. Foreword. T. Key information contained in this booklet was gathered mostly during my several years in the service of the National Cash Register Company, Dayton, Ohio, while in charge of the department known as the Employment, Promotion, and Discharge Department. I trust you may get some thought or suggestion from the information contained herein that will be of some assistance in steering you clear of many of the pitfalls for the young people who are just starting their fight for recognition in this busy business world. J.J. Munsell, Columbus, Ohio. Copyright April 1922. The stuff. The test of a man is the fight he makes, the grit that he daily shows, the way he stands on his feet and takes fate's numerous bumps and blows. A coward can smile when there's naught to fear, when nothing his progress bars, but it takes a man to stand up and cheer while some other fellow stars. It isn't the victory, after all, but the fight that a brother makes, the man who, driven against the wall, still stands up erect and takes the blows of fate with his head held high, bleeding and bruised and pale, is the man who'll win in the by and by, for he isn't afraid to fail. It's the bumps you get and the jolts you get and the shocks that your courage stands, the hours of sorrow and vain regret, the prize that escapes your hands, that test your mettle and prove your worth. It isn't the blows you deal, but the blows you take on the good old carth that show if your stuff is real. End of the topic. The value of time. There are only two great sources of value, the earth's resources as the sun, the air, the water, the ores and time. Time has no inherent value in itself. It is valuable only when used to measure useful hours. Time is the raw material which is given to each and every individual with which to forge or work out their life's work. One may use time allotted them and become a skilled mechanic, accountant, writer, artist, doctor, or lawyer, etc., while there are others who attach no value to time and seldom do they become useful citizens. We can mold our lives into successful ones or failures, just as iron may be made into cheap window weights or valuable steel springs. It is all in the handling. Do not overlook the fact that there is only one fellow in the world who can help you or hinder you. That fellow is yourself. Pity the army of unprepared, uneducated which sweeps up to the door of the business world, untrained, eager but handicapped. The business world is demanding more and more that their future employees have a foundation of health, energy, education, and knowledge upon which to build. Down below in the ranks, in the fields of the inexperienced laborers, there are always too many. It is in every way creditable and honorable to handle the pick and shovel. The only blame or discredit that I can find with anyone in such a position is not in having a higher ambition. One should not be satisfied with the limits of the tools just mentioned. End of the topic. What to do? What to do? Think of the thousands of young people that ask themselves this question, when they face the hard realities of the world early in life. It is estimated that each year, nearly 1 million young Americans enter the industrial world. 8 out of every 10 people must enter the industrial life in some of its varied phases. The entry day is a great and important event in the lives of all individuals. At the gateway of this new and unknown life, they ask themselves the above question. Beyond them lie the fields of endeavor. The business world sends forth its insistent and unending calls for recruits. There is fame to be won, honor, love, and happiness. Or there may be disappointments that wreck all the high hopes which have gilded the dreams of youth. "What am I to do?" asks the eager youth, his soul afire with ambition to serve, that he may win his heart's desire. End of the topic. Selling yourself. Getting a job for yourself is nothing more than a selling job, and when I say selling, I have in mind only that type of a salesman who handles only specialities, not an order taker who has a regular route for frequent visits to a merchant to replenish certain standard stocks, etc. When seeking a buyer for your services, you must know where to find the prospects for your goods, like any other speciality. You must create a demand. You cannot sit down and expect offers to come to you unsolicited until you have at least created a market value. To get a job, you must go after it. But you must have some definite plan of approach or guide to assist you. I know many able men who occupy inferior positions, jobs that will not return a fair reward, either in opportunity or money. They are tied down to these jobs simply because they were poor salesmen of their services. Do not misunderstand me. There are many men who get a top price for their goods from the first buyer. But unless those goods are placed in an organization where there is an unusual demand for quality, price then in the long run should not be an important factor. Better sell your services for less money as a starter and be a little more careful in selecting the buyer. Get with a live concern that keeps good goods to the front rather than get shop-worn on somebody's shelf because the price mark is too high to ask for an unknown quantity. Every job must offer room for expansion, also opportunities to make full use of all you know or can do. When you are ready to sell your services, you will, in the terms of a salesman, look for leads. You may have selected in advance the concern that you would like to have buy your services. Possibly they are not in the market, then you must look for leads for other buyers. You will find several means of approach to these leads that are used by a great many men and women of varied occupations to locate possible buyers of their services. These avenues of preach are about as follows. 1. Read the help wanted columns in the daily papers. 2. You may advertise your services for sale in the situation wanted column. 3. Either a personal call upon an employer, or if that is impossible, a letter. 4. Private employment agencies that charge a fee for registering with them, and a definite sum if they are successful in placing you. 5. Public employment offices are maintained in most of our larger cities and supported by taxation, either by the city, state, or federal governments. They are
operated. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.